Copy that. All right, buddy. Okay. Good to go. I'm going to start that question again. Sorry about that. I slept in my office a lot of nights, you know? Yeah.
How did you get your start in the industry?
It was in the right place at the right time. You know, I was 20 years old and I was going to this company that used to take sets down and store them in a warehouse, and we'd take them back out. Well, I didn't, but that was us interviewing for. They'd take the sets back out of the warehouse and set them back up for productions that would go down on hiatus, and they'd need to put the sets back up the next year. But I was in that interview and I walked out of there. I didn't get the job, and I was walking towards the door like, oh my God, what am I gonna do now? And this guy caught my arm. His name was Henry Cota, and he was a production designer for a hidden camera TV show called Spy TV on NBC. And caught my arm and he said, hey, I was walking by the office and I overheard your interview. He's like, I could use somebody like you. Do you wanna start tomorrow? And I was like, for how long? He's like, 3 months. I was like, I'll take it. And then I got in and just started building stuff for hidden camera shows. Where I started off was doing hidden camera shows. I did Scare Tactics for Sci-Fi Channel. I did the first two seasons of Punked on MTV. So that's where I got my start. And then I got in the union.
What type of sets are the most difficult to build?
Spaceship sets by far. I worked on the first season of The Orville, which is a Seth MacFarlane TV show that he wrote and produced and acted in. And I assisted in building the bridge of the ship, which was a giant elliptical shape with, it was a pretty nutty set. It was a lot of compound radiuses and angles and stuff like that. So those are definitely pretty challenging sets to build.
What are some issues you face while getting started on the first season of Yellowstone?
Well, on the first season, I think we started production a little too late, and the amount of stuff that they wanted to build from the time we started, you know, prepping to the time they wanted to shoot, I had 8 weeks to fill 3 stages, do all the construction that had to be done on location in Montana, and also all the locations that had to be done here in Utah, which is probably, you know, 8 to 10 locations. And we had 8 weeks to do all of it. So, you know, I had to hire whoever I could get my hands on. I mean, I had people from Louisiana, Georgia, Los Angeles. I had almost 100 employees. You know, we were working 14 hours a day, 7 days a week for 2 months straight with no days off. And somehow, some way, we pulled it off, and it always gets done. But it's just the anxiety that you go through in my position, because it's all on you, and they're gonna roll that camera into that set, and you're the one who's responsible to make sure it's done in time. And when we got finished, you wanna talk about the biggest feeling of relief I've ever had in my entire life. It was pretty awesome. when that stress was lifted off of me, you know. But we made it.
What is the most rewarding part of your job?
The people I get to meet. On this show specifically, I've seen some of the most beautiful nature outside some of these locations that we do, that, you know, you'll be out in the middle of Montana and you're on top of a mountain looking down, and the clouds are over top all the pine trees, and you just hear the river roaring down in the valley. And you know, that's been the most magical part of working on this show, is you know, not only getting to know the people in the area, because they're all just super amazing people. I love everyone here in Utah. I've had such a great experience here. So much so that I moved here. So, but yeah, just being outside and some of the exteriors that we get to do is just, I mean, as anyone who watches the show sees how beautiful it is where we shoot. So it's pretty awesome, amazing stuff.
What is the first step you take when you're putting a team together?
Well, the first step I take is I find the people that are my key people. So say my general foreman, my labor foreman, my paint foreman and his second. Those are the people that I hire first. Those are the people that I know will have my back, that I don't have to babysit. Not saying that everybody needs to be babysat, but you know, as a boss, sometimes you deal with, you know, intense situations and, you know, employees and stuff. But, you know, everybody here in Utah, all the carpenters that I have are amazingly talented people, and they're good people. And I've established some very strong relationships, friendships, working relationships with these people. And I mean, they're my friends. We come over to my house and we hang out, and it's, I try to keep like more of a family kind of vibe on my crew, because when it comes down to it, we spend more time with each other than we do with our own families. And that's a fact.
Now, as a construction coordinator, how important is it to have a good working relationship with the art department?
Oh, it is. That's one of the most key components of the whole thing for me, is having a good relationship with the production designer and the art director. And on this show, it's been absolutely spectacular. Carrie White and Yvonne Boudreau, they're just the most wonderful people to deal with, and it's an honor to work with them, and they're so easy to work with. Like, if I run into situations where, you know, there's a certain kind of material I can't get as fast as I need it to get here to have a set done in time, I'll just go in and be like, hey guys, like, I can't get this in this time frame. And they're like, oh cool, so just let me pick something else. And I've worked with other designers where they're like, no, I have to have that. I don't care how long it takes to get, like, figure it out. And I'm just like, I walk out of the office, I'm like, oh my God, you know? So having an art department that is flexible and willing to work with you is very key.
How do you keep such a calm demeanor?
It took years to develop that, because you know, when you first start as a construction coordinator, you put a lot of pressure on yourself to do really well. And when you first start out doing what I do for a living, you're always questioning yourself, oh my God, am I gonna get this set done on time? Am I gonna come in on budget? And over the years and all the sets that I've built and the experiences I've been through, it always gets done somehow, some way. And when I'm bidding a set, you know, I look at the designer that I'm working with and like what the blueprints are, and I go, okay, this is kind of designer, you know, maybe I'm gonna be halfway in the middle of this build and they're gonna change direction. So when I'm calculating and estimating sets and stuff, I have to take those kinds of things into consideration, you know, and pad some numbers in there for, you know, a sudden change of direction, because it happens all the time. But I just always go with my gut feeling, and every time I do that, it never fails me.
Who has been the most influential person in your career?
Oh man, okay, so his name is Phil Stone, and he's another construction coordinator. He's a very, very great, great friend of mine. And you know, as I started coordinating shows, I'd run into situations where I'd just get like super flustered, you know, and I'd always call Phil up, and he's been a construction coordinator for over 30 years. I mean, he's done some huge projects. One of the biggest projects he ever did was Stargate back in the, I think it was the 90s or something. Huge, one of the biggest builds ever. And, you know, whenever I run into situations with designers or producers, you know, things that are, you know, hard to deal with sometimes, I always call him up. I'm like, hey Phil, I'm like, this is what's going on, and you know, have you been in this situation? He's like, oh yeah. He's like, I've been in that one before. And And then he'll give me some pointers of things that I can say. And more as I've spoken to him throughout the years about things that I'm going through, I've kind of morphed my thinking into the way that he thinks, because he's really influenced me and given me a ton of great advice. And I am beyond grateful to him, because he's really assisted me to do better at my job. And the thing I loved about Phil the most is because the first shot I got as a general foreman, I worked for this guy, he would totally and completely micromanage every single thing that I did. And the first time I ever worked for Phil, he came up to me, he handed me the blueprints, and he walked away. And I'm sitting there holding the blueprints, and I'm looking around going, I can do this how I want to do it. And that right there taught me in my career to hire the people you know you can trust, so you can just hand it over and you can trust them and you can walk away and deal with what you need to deal with and not have to be worried about what their job entails, which is great.
You worked on the David Duchovny series Aquarius. What stands out in your time on that show?
Well, I was working for Phil Stone on that show. He was a construction coordinator. I was the general foreman. And we had some pretty big sets to build on that show. We built an entire police station. We built Charles Manson's house, which had this giant hillside around the back of the set. It was really cool, very fun show to work on.
David Duchovny versus Sammy Hammett. Who is the better singer, songwriter?
Really? Yes, my hobby is, I like to sing. I sing a lot of Chris Stapleton stuff, Morgan Wallen. I have a kind of a raspy rock and roll voice. And I know that you saw one of my videos on Facebook, and I had my little PA system set up in the back in the office on Yellowstone, and I had the season 2 art department gift hanging on me behind me on the wall. And remember Dean, he's one of my employees, he's from Montana, a great guy. He was sitting in there recording me, and he posted on Facebook, and in like 2 days that video had like 3,000 views. Like, it did really well. So, but I mean, not really a songwriter, but you know, I can sing my butt off, you know. I like to sing.
When did you realize you had a talent for this?
When I was in my early 20s, my sister lived in Los Angeles, and she moved out, you know, about 5 years after I was there, but she was dating this guy who his father was the lead singer for Quiet Riot for a little while. So, and he had taught his son how to sing, who was who my sister was dating. And I would always sit and hang out with him, and he could sing Led Zeppelin like spot on. Like, the guy's just an amazing singer. So he taught me how to, you know, how to sing raspy and stuff. And I just took it, and I kept working on it over the years. And, you know, eventually my sister got married to this guy, Michael Guy, who was like a, you know, songwriter, producer, worked with Rodney James Dio for several years. And, you know, I record songs with him on the off season. And, you know, he put me up against a singer from Trans-Siberian Orchestra a couple years ago. And he's, at the end of the video, he's like, "You stomped KK's head into the ground." This guy, Kelly Keeling, he's a singer for Trans-Siberian Orchestra. And, you know, I always go up and record with him, like over Christmas break. That's our thing. And it's a lot of fun. I enjoy it. You know, I don't want to be famous. I just love doing it. It's food for the soul.
Well, you have a knack for going viral, though. Who's your favorite actor you have interacted with?
Kevin Costner. Really? And he's just a gem. You know, he first season, we were still working on the second floor of the Dutton House, and he came in my office and asked us if we could clear out the set so him and Modern West could do a little country music television clip up in there. And then he told us, you know, hey, if you guys want to come up and watch. And so we came up and watched the whole clip. And at the end, he came back and he shook my hand and said thanks a lot and appreciate you guys letting us get in here and use the set even though it's not done yet. And it was just, he's just a really nice man. And you know, and it's crazy for me because I grew up with my mom watching Dances with Wolves I don't know how many times. And I'm from a small town in West Virginia, Parkersburg, West Virginia. I had no idea what I was going to be doing in high school. And to be in the places and talking to the people that I get to talk to is like a dream come true for me. And I had no idea when I was in high school that I was going to be doing what I'm doing for a living. And I would have been so excited back then if I would have known. But it was like, I was that kid who was like, I don't know what I'm going to do with my life, you know. And then I just landed in this, and one thing led to another, and here I am sitting here talking to you, you know. So,
lastly, what are your thoughts on the Utah Film Studios?
The Utah Film Studios, in my opinion, is one of the most state-of-the-art facilities that I've ever worked at. The staff here is amazing. You know, I've made great friends with all of you guys, you know, and we always work together. And, you know, I'm just extremely grateful for this facility, and I loved it so much. I bought a house 15 minutes from here, and I'm trusting in the future that I will do more shows here other than Yellowstone, you know. But it's just, it's a state-of-the-art, well-kept, very clean, brand-new facility. And it's very production friendly in my opinion.
Finish your whiskey. You're a sweet strawberry wine. You're as warm as a glass of brandy. And honey, Tennessee whiskey.